We are in Parashat Pinchas, and Pinchas is in Eretz Yisrael, and outside of Eretz Yisrael, they're still in Parashat Balak, and we're going to learn from the Zera Shimshon on the Parasha. Now, Parashat Pinchas, of course, is famous for the act that Pinchas did, and which is not accurate, by the way, because the act that he did was last week. Just this week, it's being mentioned the reward that he got, but the actual act we read last week in Parashat Balak. But Parashat Pinchas is also famous for another part in it, that all the Torah readings for all the holidays are in Parashat Pinchas. So for the ones of you who join us for prayers, we only have one Sefer Torah, so every time we have a holiday, it's rolling the Torah, rolling. Why? Because we have to go back to Parashat Pinchas. So in the beginning of the year, when the Torah is in Bereshit on Shemot, you have to roll the Torah a lot. So all the readings of the holidays are in Parashat Pinchas. All the sacrifices of the holidays. This is another big thing that the Parasha is famous for, is all the sacrifices of all the festivals. So in our Parasha, it is talking about the sacrifice that was brought on Rosh Hashanah. So it goes as follows. There is a Midrash, Midrash Rabbah. Interestingly, the Midrash Rabbah is on the book of Vayikra, but Midrash comes from the word drasha, is to explain and to dissect. So there's a drasha in Midrash Rabbah about a verse in our week's parasha. This can be found in chapter 21, this parasha, Parashat Pinchas, chapter, verse Aleph and Bet. And the verse is goes as follows: Yom Teruah Yelachem. This is going to be a day of shofar sounding, of course referring to Rosh Hashanah. Va'asitem Ola, you shall offer up a burnt offering. And this is a very interesting way of expressing. And I told you many times, most people, they read the parasha like a newspaper, and they don't pay attention to the details. That's why Baruch Hashem we have the sages that start questioning. So comes here a big question on this verse, and I'll read the verse again in Hebrew. Yom Teruah Yelachem, this is referring to the seventh, the first day of the seventh month, which of course is Rosh Hashanah. Yom Teruah Yelachem V'asitem Ola, a day of shofar sounding for you, and you should offer up a burnt offering. Okay, comes a rabbi, Amar Rav Tachlifa, this is in the Talmud, Bechol Musafin, in all the sacrifices that is called Musaf. I'm sure when you come to Shul on Shabbat or on Yom Tov, there's a prayer called Musaf. Musaf is an addition. So this is a certain korban, a certain sacrifice that is called Musaf. He says, Bechol Musafin Ktiv, in all the Musafin, in this sacrifice, it says, Vehikravtem. Here, Vekan Ktiv Vasitem Ola. This is very few people stop to say, wait a minute, how come in all the other places it says the word Vehikravtem, you should sacrifice, or you should bring? I mean, the translation is really should be you should sacrifice, but it says you should bring. But how come all the Musafim it says Vehikravtem, and in this Musaf he says Vehavitem, and you should Vasitem, sorry, and you would do. And what do you do? You do Ola. Hakitzad, how can it be? Why is the Torah switching? So he's presenting an interesting question. What is he answering? Amar lehem HaKadosh Baruch Hu Yisrael, Hashem, God told the nation of Israel, Banai, my sons, Ani ma'ale alechem, I will, so to say, add, like as if, Ke'ilu hayom na'asitem lefanai. When you offer the sacrifice, I will consider it like as if today you were created. Okay. Barati etchem, hayom barati etchem b'riyah chadasha. Today I made you a brand new creation. Hadao dichtiv, as it says in the book of Yeshayahu, Isaiah 66, chapter 66, verse 22. And it says, Ki ka'asher ha-shamayim chadashim, va'aretz ha-chadasha. For it's the new heavens and the new earth that I am making. He's taking a verse from Yeshayahu. Okay. So we have two ways how the Torah is referring to a Korban Musaf. In all the cases it says the word Va'asitem, and in this specific verse it says Ve'asitem. Sorry, in all the places it says Ve'ikravtem, you should offer the sacrifice. Here it says Va'asitem, and you will do it. Okay. Now, we have to be very precise in the text. This is where the Torah becomes interesting. If you just read it on the surface, okay, so you're reading text. When you stop and you start, this is called Lidrosh. This is the level of the Torah that is called Drash. Now, let's be particular about sometimes the word, how many times the Torah is using the same word, with the Vav, without the Vav, with an Aleph, without the Aleph. Why? There has to be a reason. So he says, Yesh ledakdek, we have to be precise. What is the benefit that Hashem says, I will pretend, or I will accept it like as if today you were done. So I'm now, basically what he's saying, I'm now in sacrificing a sacrifice, and Hashem says, by you sacrificing this specific sacrifice, I will consider it like as if I just created you. Saying in other words, I'm resetting your status. You are like a brand new baby. So what's the benefit in that? Why is he saying such a thing?
Teshuvah.
Excuse me?
Teshuvah.
Yeah, exactly. Perfect. Teshuvah. Now he says, so what's the benefit? Now he's taking us to a very interesting pirush. I told you already, the Zera Shimshon, in the last few classes, I'm sure you noticed, he brings out all these beautiful books, all these beautiful mefarshim that are not so common. So he says here, Kmo shepiresh hayafet toar, yafet toar, is the translation is very handsome. It says about Yosef, he was Yafet Toar. It says also about Rachel, Yafat Toar. But nevertheless, this is a commentary about a certain rabbi. His name is Shmuel Yafet. So his commentary is called Yafet Toar. His name is Shmuel Yafet Ashkenazi. Some people know him, some people don't know him. Lived about 450 years ago. I believe he died at the late 1500s. And he's famous on a perush about a commentary he did on Midrash Rabbah. And he was born in Turkey, lived most of the time in Turkey, and he's one of the students of Rabbi Shlomo Elkabetz. So Shlomo Elkabetz is one of our neighbors here, the author of the Lecha Dodi, he's one of his students. Nevertheless, he has a beautiful book, and the book is called Yafet Toar. This is a perush, a very deep interpretations and commentary about the Midrash. So he says as follows, Kmo sheperesh hayafet toar, like the yafet toar explains, ולמה חזר לומר כאילו היום בראתי אתכם? Why does it say it like as if I created? Either say I created you, but now he's saying as if I created you. בריאה חדשה, brand new. דהיינו, ואם התועלת באה להם מחמת שנעשו מעצמם, if they get any type of benefit that they were so to say renewed, אם כן, כאילו היום בראתי אתכם, so it's giving them the status like as if the הקדוש ברוך הוא just created them. דמשמע, what do we learn from that? שהקדוש ברוך הוא יברא אותם גריאות הוא להם. If we're going by the fact that the הקדוש ברוך הוא is creating them, then what do we understand from that? That is something not good for them, that the Kadosh Baruch Hu, so to say, recreates them. But nevertheless, that brings another question. Od kashe, ha-reaya she-mavim mi-pasuk ki kasher ha-shamayim ha-chadashim. What makes it harder to understand is that the proof that he's bringing is from the verse of Yeshayahu. Deze ma-iri le-atid b'chidush ha-olam. What is it referring to? What is the verse of Yeshayahu referring to? To the future. What's going to happen in the future? Then HaKadosh Baruch Hu, so to say, makes a brand new creation. Here Isaiah Yeshayahu is saying, in the future, the HaKadosh Baruch Hu is going to remove all our sins, whoever does tshuva, wipe everything out, so I become a Briyah Chadasha, I'm brand new. What does that got to do now with the fact that when I'm doing a Korban Musaf? ויש לומר שהעניין הוא כך. Now let's explain it. שהתשובה באמת היא מכפרת. If a person does תשובה, it will atone for the sin that the person did. Yeah, you do תשובה, the Torah will guarantee to you, it will atone for your sin. But you know what? עדיין צריך למרק את הנאת החטא. You got forgiveness. but the blemish of the sin is still there. It's very nice that you did tshuva. I told you already, when I was 8 or 9 years old, I went with my brand new football, and I was kicking it on walls, because if you kick it on the wall, the ball comes back to you. And one time I kicked it too strong, I missed the wall by a few centimeters, and the ball went flying 50 kilometers an hour into a huge stained glass window of my neighbor's. And it shattered it to pieces, and I wasn't so sophisticated then, I ran away. I thought, if I'll run away, nobody knows it's me. So I run away, and moments later, there's a knock on the door. I climb on the chair, because I wasn't that tall, and I look in the hole, and I see the neighbor. what is he doing here? So I open the door, like with a naive face. Hello, how can I help you? So he pulls out the ball. Is this yours? And I'm like, looks like mine. Anyways, I got caught in the act. Now, what was the result? My father had to pay for the expensive window. I had to pay the whole summer by working, but my father had to pay for the window. So why am I telling you this? Because my father told me even then, I had to say sorry, of course, I didn't mean to, it was a mistake. So my father told me that, it's very nice that you said sorry, but you still have to pay for the window. So you do tshuva, it's very nice you did tshuva, but you still have to pay for the sin you did. So that's it, I'm going to steal now $1 million, I'll tell you, I'm so sorry. I really apologize for taking your money. Give the money back! So same thing here. He says, the tshuva mechaperet, the tshuva will not atone for what you did. אבל עדיין צריך למרק את הנעת החטא. You still have to clean the remaining of the sin. And usually the sin, here it's saying it in a very interesting way, הנעת החטא. You got pleasure? You got pleasure from the sin? Usually sins are pleasurable. You don't sin and you suffer. Usually you will sin because you have benefit from it, some type of physical or emotional pleasure. Nevertheless, there is a blemish from the sin that you have to wash off. The tshuva is stage one. Now go wash the sin off. How is it done? וזה נעשה לפעמים על ידי סורין. In some cases, it will be done by hardship. Yisurim. You have to go through suffering. But nevertheless, לפעמים על ידי רחמים עליונים. Sometimes it will be done by mercy. הקדוש ברוך הוא decides to be merciful and he erases the sin with no hardship. I mean, just that you know, I can't say it in percentage, but just for the sake of the example, I would say that 50 to 80% of the suffering that you go through is your own sins. You did a sin. Whether you did tshuva or not, then comes yesurim, comes suffering. Yeah, you can only blame yourself. Don't blame anybody else. But nevertheless, sometimes the Kadosh Baruch Hu has great mercy, and he says, I'll forgive you without any hardship. וזהו שאנו אומרים, if you notice, this is the source is in the Talmud, in Tractate Brachot, in page 17. But every night when we say Kriyat Shema Lamita, hopefully you say Kriyat Shema Lamita, what do we say to the Kadosh Baruch Hu? Mechok, he should erase, Berachamecha Rabim, אבל לא על ידי יסורים. Please erase my sins, but not with hardship. And that's most of the Sidurim, that you say Kriyat Shema Lamita, hopefully you say that, because that's, according to the Arizal, the best way to remove all the stains from the neshama, is to say Kriyat Shema Lamita. But we say, please forgive me and erase all my sins, but not al yedei surim. Berachamim, do it with mercy. Umeata, im tzadik echad yichta, what happens if a person can be considered as a tzaddik? And I'm not talking about Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai or the Arizal or Rabbi Nachman from Breslev or any other tzaddik. I'm talking about a person that most of his actions are righteous. He can be called a tzaddik, but sometimes he also does sins. Im tzaddik echad yecheta, shebevadai yaseh tshuva, but nevertheless for sure he's going to do tshuva. Listen, we're all human, we all sin. Let's face it, we all sin at least 100 times every day. But at least I have the ability, the awareness, the means, and the knowledge how to do tshuva right away. I did a sin, I go and correct it. And then there's nothing wrong with that. It's actually good. If Hashem already made you sin, it's so you can do tshuva and climb to a higher level. So techev umiyad yaseh tshuva, kede amrinan, as it says in the Talmud, same page, in the tractate ברכות, this is in page 19. אם ראית תלמיד חכם שעבר עבירה בלילה, אל תערער אחריו ביום. If you saw a תלמיד חכם, a sage doing a sin at night, don't think about him bad in the morning, because most likely he did tshuva already right away. And sometimes you look at a person and you're saying, hey, that person did something not so good. Okay, listen, we're all human. We make mistakes, as long as you know how to do tshuva. הדין היה נותן שתהיה תשובתו מקובלת לגמרי. If a person did תשובה, okay, you made a mistake, you did תשובה, the תשובה will be accepted. I'm not talking right now of a person that systematically sins. I'm not talking completely about a person that deliberately goes against the Kadosh Baruch Hu. That's a whole different category. I'm talking about people like us, that the majority of our actions are positive, and here and there we sin. Listen, we're human. And you do תשובה, your תשובה will be accepted. ולא יהיה בכך צורך כלל לאיסורים. Now if this is the case, then you don't have to go through hardship. If you really did tshuva right away, okay, you insulted somebody, you didn't mean to. The next day, right away, you come and say, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to. How can I appease you? Or you took something. How many times you take something? The next day you come back and say, listen, I don't want to be failing in gezel. Do I owe you money? I took it by mistake. So, nevertheless, if the person does tshuva right away, the tshuva will be accepted. And in most cases, he's not going to have to go through yisurim. Why? Because Hashem says, listen, I try to teach you a lesson, you stumble, whatever, I accept your תשובה. ולהפך, on the other side, אם חוטא אחד, הרבה. What if on the other side, if a person sins all the time? לפשוע, but he does that because he knows what he's doing, but it's easy money, or whatever. ואחר כך שב בתשובה, and then he does תשובה. You know, a lot of people say, let me sin today, and tomorrow, and the next day, I'll do תשובה, יום כיפור. What's your, when is יום כיפור? 4 months from now? I'll do תשובה then. I'll give some money, I'll come and go like this in the shul, and I'll do תשובה. שזאת התשובה לא תחפר לו לגמרי. This תשובה is not going to really help him. אלא שעדיין הוא צריכים יסורים למרק. Let's say the person, first of all, if a person does a sin counting on the תשובה, it's going to be very hard for this person to do תשובה. The verse goes, כל האומר אכתב ואשוב, אכתב ואשוב, אין מספיקים בידו לעשות תשובה. If a person says, I will sin and do תשובה, I will sin and do תשובה, they don't let him do תשובה from Shemaim. But the Talmud explains, it's not that they close the gates of תשובה, they just don't assist him. Now, to do תשובה without assistance is almost impossible. That's how it is. Kadosh Baruch Hu gives us what's called Sayata Deshmaya, help from above. So Kadosh Baruch Hu lifts up 99 pounds, I have to lift up 1 pound. But if I don't have assistance from Hashem, to do tshuva without the Kadosh Baruch Hu helping me, that's almost impossible. But nevertheless, if a person does sins and sin and sin and sin, finally he does tshuva, but he's repeatedly doing the sin, then the tshuva is not going to be so helpful. Now there's going to have to come yisurim, hardship. Why? למרק הנעת החטאים, to remove and to clean the pleasure that the person received from the sin. אבל אנו רואים שהעולם אינו מתנהג על פי סדר זה, but we see that the majority of the world is not going according to this order. שהרי יש קונה עולמו בשעה אחת. Where do we see that? We just learned last week, I told you the story about Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya, that he was a big, big sinner. And I'll tell you quickly the story, but the ones who didn't hear, this is can be found in tractate Avodah Zarah, page 17. Go and read the whole story, very inspiring story. The individual was called Elazar ben Dordaya. He was a big sinner. His yetzer hara was women. He was going from one party to another party, from this ship to that ship. He was the biblical Hugh Hefner. But nevertheless, all along partying. And that was his sin. And it says that he would travel across the world just to find a woman, a special woman. Nevertheless, somebody came to him at some point and told him, Elazar, you have lost all chances of doing tshuva. You are a lost case, as they say. His heart was broken into pieces. What? I don't have any chance? The story is long, but he went and he prayed for the sun, for the moon, for the stars, for the heavens. Please ask for mercy for me. You are huge. Please ask for mercy for me. And they said, no, if we're already asking for mercy, we'll ask mercy on ourselves. The story is long, but I'm just telling you a few of the details. He became very, very sad. It's the Talmud says he went and sat between two mountains and he cried and he cried and he cried a whole hour till his soul left his body. The second that he died and left his body from his own sorrow, a voice, a heavenly voice came out and says, Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya, Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya, the Olam Haba is inviting you. You have a place in Olam Haba. At that time, it was the time of this period of the Second Temple where the chief rabbi of the generation was Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi, Rabbi. He heard that and he said the famous quote, Yesh Adam Koneh Olamo Berega. B'sha'achat, sorry. A person can buy his entire world to come in 1 hour. Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya cried for 1 hour, he did sincere tshuva, and he died, and he went into Olam Haba, to the world to come. So the story, this is the story, this is a short version of the story, but nevertheless, it says here, Hare yesh kone olamo b'sha'achat. A person can do 1 hour of tshuva, and that's it. Can you imagine? An hour before you die, you can do tshuva, and you're good to go. But on the other hand, Yesh tzedikim shenidonim beisurim rabim. Some righteous people, their whole life is isurim. Their whole life is hardship. Actually, if you look at most of the tzedikim, look what life they went through. Poverty, sickness, diseases, hardship. So here a person sins all his life, does 1 hour tshuva, and he walks in, and here you see a tzedik that suffers. Okay, now maybe we can explain that a little bit. It says in the Talmud in Yerushalmi, in a tractate what's called Bikurim, chapter 3, Halacha 3, Chacham, Chatan, Venasi. You have a Chacham is a sage, a wise person, a Chatan, a groom, and a Nasi, a president or a prince. Gedulatan Mechaperet. Their level makes their sin be forgiven. So if a person becomes a chacham, a talmid chacham, then his sins will be forgiven. Chatan, I'm sure you heard that the chatan, on the day of the wedding, his sins get forgiven. I know some people, they get divorced, they get married, they get divorced, they get married. They say, well, maybe I get my sins. It's a good way. Instead of Yom Kippur, I'll divorce my wife. You know, there's a mitzvah to marry your divorced wife. So I know somebody thinks it's a loophole. I'll divorce her, I'll marry her. Divorce her, and every time I have a wedding, all my sins are being erased. And of course, a Nasi. Nasi is a president, but not President Trump. Rather, Nasi is Nasi lebet Av Beit Israel, for a tribe, Nasi Beit Din, Av Beit Din. It's a very high level, not a president, as they say now in our days. Nevertheless, the Talmud says in the Sanhedrin, these are the three people, Gedulatan, their greatness, their level that they reach, Mechaperet, Vuantoin, atone for their sins. Now comes a question on that. Kashe, the imayri belo tshuva pshita. So what? The person marries and he doesn't need to do tshuva and whoop, lottery, all the sins are out. That doesn't make sense. Pshita shagdula en la kol kach koach lechaper. Wait a minute. You're saying the person will do that without tshuva? No, has to be tshuva. I have a few grooms that came to me and told me, that's it, I'm out today. I'm just wearing a white robe, a kittel or whatever. I'm a groom today. All my sins are forgiven. Not so fast, pretty boy. Do tshuva first. Then the day will assist you. It's not that you just waltz into the chuppah and that's it. You gained the system to be reset. Do tshuva. If you do tshuva, then the day of you being a groom will assist you. It's almost like Yom Kippur. Some people say, listen, all year I will sin. I'll do whatever I want. Yom Kippur, I'm not going out of the shul. I will fast, I will give a lot of money, I will pray. What do you think this is? You're going to bribe the Kadosh Baruch Hu? You think you're going to sin all day long for the whole year and one day you sit in the shul, give a nice check and say a few prayers? Kadosh Baruch Hu will throw you out of the window. What are you talking about? You have to do tshuva. And you have to go 40 days in Elul to do tshuva. Then maybe Yom Kippur will help you. You know that most people, Yom Kippur doesn't help them. First of all, Yom Kippur does not help any sin between me and another person. End of story. There's no place even to argue here. If I sinned against you, Yom Kippur is worthless to me. It's just another day. Yom Kippur is only between me and Hashem. And Hashem says, if so-and-so doesn't forgive you, I can't forgive you. So Hashem gives us 40 days in Elul to go, and excuse my language, to kistuches to everybody, to appease everybody that I angered, so they can forgive me, so then I can come on Yom Kippur, and Hashem will forgive me. Yom Kippur is not that I just waltz into the shul, and that's it, the day. Well, you have to do tshuva. Same thing here. It says, what are you telling me? That's what the Talmud is questioning. You're just telling me the guy walks into the chuppah and he gets forgiven? No, no, no. You have to do tshuva. Therefore, the greatness is not the component for the atonement. What do we learn from that? It's the tshuva that gains you the atonement. Aval, אינה מסרת החץ, לגמרי. תשובה is very nice. It's for the Kadosh Baruch Hu not to be angry, or not to be, not to punish you. But you still have the existence of the sin that you are obligated to remove. The tshuva is thus just to get you out of the court. That's why the Talmud says, this can be found in Tractate Yoma. It says if a person does transgress a negative mitzvah, he mixes wool and linen. You're not allowed to mix wool and linen. This is a negative mitzvah from the Torah, precept. A person does such a avera, such a sin, he does tshuva. Now what does the tshuva do? He puts the sin on hold, tshuva tola. Now the sin is on hold, and he has to wait till Yom Kippur, and then Yom Kippur will erase the sin. That's for a simple sin. Severe sins, Yom Kippur not always helps. But nevertheless, when I do tshuva, it just removes away the judgment. But the sin still exists. I have to remove it. This is called that I have to lemarek to clean the blemish of the sin. So the tshuva is good; it atones, but eina maseret achet legamre. It doesn't remove the sin completely. You have to remove it. There are two ways of removing it. Leolam tzarich yisurim lemarek achet. You're going to have to go through some hardship. Why specifically hardship? Because there's a stain on the nefesh, on the garments of the nefesh, and you want to get something off, you scrub. And the scrubbing is a little bit painful. So when you next time you have some hardship, say thank you to the Kadosh Baruch Hu, who is washing you. Umi shezoche la'alot legdula, but if a person gains to go to a very high level, nitzol min hayisurim ve'nitkaper legamrei. After you did tshuva, if you become in a high level, then you can do remove the sin without hardship. Which means after you did serious tshuva, suddenly you became a great rabbi, then your greatness will allow the sins to be wiped off without hardship. You did tshuva, then you became a chatan, then that will allow you and so forth. So the gdula, the greatness, will only help after you did tshuva. והיינו המרוק נעשה על ידי הרחמים העליונים. Then the cleaning is done by רחמים, by mercy, and not by severe hardship. Okay. ובזה נבוא לביור המדרש. Now we can understand the midrash, what the midrash says. בכל המוספים כתיב והקרבתם. If you remember what we were talking about, that in all the מוספים, all the sacrifices, it says the word והקרבתם, which I can translate והקרבתם, it brings you closer. Yes, the translation means you should bring an offering. But nevertheless, the literal translation means brings you closer. דהיינו שהחותם מתקרב עצמו לקדושה. That the one who sinned gets closer to קדושה. ועל ידי הקורבן, by the sacrifice. והקורבן מועיל לו. And the sacrifice will help you get your atonement. לכפרתו ולהקריבו לקדושה. And to get you closer to kedusha, to holiness. אבל עדיין צריך למרק הנאת החטא ולתקן כל מה שנפגם. But still you have to remove the blemish or the stain from the sin. ואפשר שיינם ילדי איסורים. So it can happen also by hardship. ובכאן כתיב, but in our verse, it doesn't say the word והקרבתם. The first option is that I come with a sacrifice. I mean, now we don't have Bet HaMikdash, unfortunately, but when Bet HaMikdash was standing, I would come with a sacrifice, I would give it to the Kohen, and what do you know? The sin gets removed. This is a kapara. I atone for my sin. But then I will have to go through hardship, Yisurim. In our generation, unfortunately, yet, we don't have Mashiach. We don't have a Bet HaMikdash. So the sacrifice can come in other ways. But nevertheless, we still have to go through hardship. But the whole point of a sacrifice is to get me closer to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. But here in the verse that we're quoting in our parasha, it says, "Hayom asitem," uses the word "you will do." Atzmechem lifanai, you do it in front of me. Dahainu, what does that mean? Kmo ger shenitgayer, like a convert who just got converted. You know, a convert when he gets converted, he, she, they reset the system. Back to square one, like a baby. Kekatan shenolad dami, like a baby that was just born. Can you imagine pressing a button and you're like a baby? No sins, you're back to day one. באופן שהעבירות הקדמות לא תזכרנה עוד. In a way that the previous sins disappear. She totally erased the system. Blackout. The whole database is erased. Not too long ago, one of my computers crashed. Everything got deleted. The good and the bad. Not there was many bad, but everything got deleted. All the files. Nevertheless, so this is what happens with a convert. A convert gets converted. Everything disappears. Brand new. Here comes the question, אם תאמרו אף בגר שנתגייר, if you're talking here about a ger, a convert that got converted, איקה מן דאמר באחולת, someone that will say, this is about a chapter in the tractate יבמות called החולת, this can be found in the tractate יבמות, page F48, שהם מעונים ויסורים באים אליהם מחמת שלא קיימו שבע מצוות קודם שנתגיירו. What happens about a convert that gets converted and still will go through hardship? You know why? Because before he converted, he didn't fulfill the seven laws of Noah. That's it. That's a sin. You know, many people that are not Jewish, you know why they're considered sinners? Because they don't do the seven laws of Noah. If they will fulfill the seven laws of Noah, they have no problem. But what happens is with a convert. If a convert now comes to convert, then what about the times you didn't do the seven laws of Noach? The fact that you converted now is very nice, but aren't you held liable for the 40 years prior to that you didn't do the seven laws of Noach before you converted? Vim ken, ma toilet lano liot keder shenitgayer. Now if this is the case, that the convert has baggage, so to say, from the times that he didn't do the seven laws of Noach, he or she, then what's the benefit that you're saying that if I do tshuva, I'm like a ger, because he's saying, you're like a convert, you start from scratch. Mishum hachi yosif kilu hayom barati etchem. Therefore, then he adds in the Midrash, like Hashem says, like as if I created you today. Briya chadasha, you're brand new. Dichtiv ki kasher ha-shamayim ha-chadashim. As Isaiah says, like the new sky. דהיינו כאילו כבר נתתי לכם נשמה חדשה, meaning that I already gave you a new soul. It's basically a parable, משל העתיד, it's going on the future, דכתיב, as it says in the book of Ezekiel, יחזקאל 36, chapter 36, verse 626, ונתתי לכם לב חדש, I will give you a new heart. This is going on the future, you're going to get a new heart. ואסירותי לב האבן, and I will remove the heart of stone from you. ונתתי לכם לב בשר, I will give you a real heart. שלא תקבלו יסורים כלל. After Mashiach comes, the atonement was not going to be with יסורים. We're not going to have hardship. וזה בשביל כבוד וקדושת היום. Now when is all this happening? For the honor and the קדושה of the day of Rosh Hashanah. שגורם כך, because the holiness of the Rosh Hashanah will cause that the Kadosh Baruch Hu, if a person does תשובה, is like as if a בריאה חדשה. Brand new. So this is as a side note, that on Rosh Hashanah, a person can do tshuva to such an extent that he becomes like a brand new baby. Like as if no sins at all. Just imagine what a level. שיש תוספת טהרה וקדושה בנשמה. That it allows to add an addition of קדושה, holiness and טהרה and purity, much more. Why? מחמת הרגל כנודע. From the regel, from the auspicious day. Which means that on Aleph Tishrei, Rosh Hashanah, the day itself can allow the person after he did tshuva to become brand new. Can you imagine? All your sins disappear. This is what imagine the lottery you're winning here. וכלומר, as one can say, שתהיו כמו הגרים, and according to Rabbi Yossi says this is like a convert. This can be found in Tractate Yabamot, exactly where I told you, page 48. Because one opinion says, wait a minute, He says it to the converts. Don't come waltzing here like as if you just came in and you're brand new. You still have to do tshuva for the seven laws of Noach you didn't do prior to your conversion. This is one opinion in the Talmud. There's a different opinion in the Talmud. This is brought by Rabbi Yossi. And pokudim aleim shum cheta kodem. According to Rabbi Yossi, you can't attach a sin to a convert before they converted. Like the other opinion, it says aman de'amar. Aman de'amar, we don't know who says that. Aman de'amar says somebody said. But somebody said, yeah, convert, we're very happy you converted. But you still have to do tshuva for all the time that you were a non-Jew and you didn't do the seven laws of Noach. According to Rabbi Yossi, no. No, we don't. It's not the right approach. A convert that converts is brand new, like as if nothing happened, like a baby that was born. Lefish nishtanu beguf nefesh. Why is that the opinion of Rabbi Yossi? Because their body changes and their soul changes. You get a brand new soul. So this is the opinion of Rabbi Yossi. Why are we adding this portion? Because the Kadosh Baruch Hu and the commentary says that when you do tshuva, a real tshuva, you're like a brand new creation. And he gives two examples, like a convert that got converted and a baby that was born. So you erase everything. So it's important to come to be more correct when we're saying, why, there's a question, why are you saying like a convert? There is an opinion in the Talmud says that even a convert has to do tshuva. And by the way, to some opinions up until today, there will be rabbis that will tell a convert, yeah, you have a brand new soul and your body is renewed, so to say, but you still have to do tshuva for your past, for the seven laws of Noach that you didn't do. So do tshuva, what's the big deal? Do tshuva, anyways you have an auspicious moment, go to the mikveh and you're good to go. But nevertheless, this is this difference of opinions. But what we want to take from that is that we have an opportunity to do tshuva. And I know now it's early, we're only in Tammuz, but Tishrei is around the corner, by the way. We have half of Tammuz, all the month of Av, Elul, and back to Tishrei. Listen, this is around the corner. 2.5 months, they go like that. So the point to take from that is the good news that Hashem does accept tshuva even for severe, severe sins. But as long as the tshuva is done the right way, then Hashem will accept the tshuva. Now we have to be careful with the hardship that will come. First of all, we want to take from that is we all go through hardship. One person struggles with livelihood, with parnasa. Another person struggles with health. Another person struggles with can't get married. Another person struggles with all of them together. We all have struggles and challenges and hardships. Sometimes the hardship just can be a flat tire. And it's going to cost you now a lot of money to fix the tire. And you're late for the meeting. And you're standing in the sun and you got dirty. This can be surim. Instead of cursing and getting upset, say, Baruch Hashem, thank you so much. You probably removed a chunk that was stuck on my body, on my soul, from one of my sins, and it was removed. So our sages say, like, one should accept the hardship with love. So this is as a side note. Here we have a loophole that one can say, wait a minute, if you want your sins to be removed without hardship, then go to a great level. Like it says, if a person becomes a great rabbi, then the miruk, the cleaning, is done by rachamim. So you can strive to become great, and everybody can be great in their way. So the real message we want to take from here is the power of tshuva. And a lot of people don't understand the ability they have with tshuva. That one can do serious tshuva, and okay, we'll go through a little bit of hardship, but nevertheless can be accepted and completely be cleaned from everything they did. A lot of people are worried, there's no tshuva, I'll never be able to remove it. The Torah comes and tells you, don't worry, tshuva is more powerful than anything. And this is what we want to take from that, that unfortunately, you know, we're human, we sin, we do many things, but we have the power of tshuva. The tshuva has to be authentic, it has to be real, real tshuva. It's just not just trying to mop something underneath the rug, but with real tshuva, then our sins get forgiven. And this is just an addition to for us to take the consideration that when we pray every night, Kriyat Shema L'Amidah, then you want to ask and request the Kadosh Baruch Hu that please erase all my sins, aval lo al yedei yisurim, not with hardship, with rachamim, Have rachamim, you can arouse rachamim. It's a good time to arouse mercy from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And Bezrat Hashem, with a real tshuva, then the Kadosh Baruch Hu should forgive all our sins and clean us. And as Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai says in the Talmud, Im Yisrael osim tshuva, miyad nigalim. If we do tshuva, then we get redeemed right away. So Bezrat Hashem, we should all be very focused on our tshuva. So if we do the right tshuva, we can hasten the geula, and Bezrat Hashem right away be redeemed.